Your Excellency, distinguished guests and fellow colleagues, welcome to today's CLC lecture series. My name is Jasmine and I'm from the Center for Livable Cities. The center was jointly established by the Ministry of National Development and the Ministry of the Environment and Water Resources in 2008 to distill, create and share knowledge on livable and sustainable cities. The CLC lecture series is one of the platforms through which urban thought leaders share best practices and exchange ideas and experiences. In today's session, we are honored to have with us Mr. Henk Ovink, the Special Envoy for International Water Affairs in the Kingdom of the Netherlands. He will share how both Singapore and the Netherlands have driven innovation through scarcity and how small urbanized cities can adapt drivers of innovation to deal with complex public issues. The presentation will be followed by a moderated panel discussion and a Q&A session with the audience, which will be moderated by Mr. Chua Soon Guan, Deputy Chief Executive Policy and Development at the PUB, the National Water Agency. With this, let us begin the session by inviting Mr. Ovink on stage. Mr. Ovink, please.
Thanks for the mic. I just changed my presentation. This is what happens. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the comparison between the Netherlands and Singapore, but only in the end. First, perhaps more important things. Well, the power of place is at the heart of both Singapore and the Netherlands. So the images I share here with you of Singapore and the Netherlands, of course, strike differences, at the same time similarities. But first things first, as you know. You know this, right? You know who she is. Sometimes we call her a little grumpy. Yeah. She looks grumpy. I would look grumpy if this was my main flood protection system with a country like Germany. This is scary. Anyone know where this is?
Singapore.
Nah. Good. I don't know, but this is Miami. And the guy who's in the sewage, because he's actually in the sewage, is finding the leak. But this is not a leak. This is the ocean bubbling up. And this is happening almost every day now in Miami. The water rises through the sewage system into the street. Water is serious. And water scarcity, pollution and too much water is at the heart of many conflicts around the world. One of those conflicts being in Syria. Research showed that water, bad water management, and the scarcity and the drought increased the conflict. But if you turn that around, it means that water management in the wrong hands can become a weapon of mass destruction. And then we're in a different world. Next quiz question. Where are we? Too complicated, I guess. This is the Colorado River. Any one of you know the Grand Canyon by image? It's big, huh? Grand Canyon. Grand Canyon, big canyon. This river created the Grand Canyon. This river. Nothing's left of it here. This is nothing to do with climate change, although climate change increases the bad situation. 65 years ago was the last time the Grand Canyon touched the Gulf of Mexico. Now it's only drops that cross the border between the US and Mexico. So again, bad management, bad pricing, bad governance. The canals in Amsterdam, We show different pictures, of course, of Amsterdam, but only 10 years ago, a swan built a nest on the garbage in our canals. It was the image that started a campaign to clean them. And now our queen swims in the canals, so they must be safe, sound, and good. But it took a while. It takes these images to stress the importance, to stress these challenges. 50% of the population in Africa does not have access to clean drinking water. 50%. And this is the quality of the water in Kenya. Not a good thing. Kira Bash, from a Dutch perspective, not so far away from Singapore. Actually, it is still a pretty long travel. This is an older picture from a Dutch photographer who was chasing water around the world, a good friend. I'm not sure, but I think the woman is not living in her house anymore because of sea level rise and climate change. We need to perceive these issues of water and climate change and urbanization through the lens of collaboration. Ever talk to an astronaut or listen to one? We have a Dutch, famous Dutch one who travels the Netherlands and says the planet is blue. It's a lie. The planet is not blue, it's only paint. It's a little tiny little surface. If you take all the water of the world, all the water of the world, this is everything you have. There is no more water, nothing more. That's all the water. But if you want to use water for the industry, agriculture, energy, mankind to drink, water is life. This is the only drop you have. There's a smaller one even, but this is the only drop you have. 170 miles, 250 kilometers in diameter is all the water we can use. Water is a scarce good. People will feel the impact of climate change most strongly and profoundly through water. 90% of all disasters is already water related. It's impacting in the next decades 2 billion people because of too much water, and almost another 2 billion because of a lack of water. Impacting 40% of the world's population and 15% of our regional GDPs. This summer, last summer, research showed that 50% of the largest aquifers, so this is where we store our water naturally, these ground levels, that have water storage capacities, and they're big, as you see on the map, 50% of them are already past their tipping point. And that sounds abstract, you know, past their tipping point, and let's have dinner. Past their tipping point, let's have drinks. Past the tipping point means that natural recovery is impossible. That is past the tipping point. So we exploit the water, so a natural recovery is impossible. The only way, the most positive scenario, is stabilization, which is almost impossible in such a case. Now, the impact of water on our cities, on our environment, on our people is big. So, World Bank calculated the risks of water in 2050. And those risks add up to billions. And because it's not so sharp, I will just name them. Miami is top of the list. $278 billion at risk in 2050. Guangzhou is second, then New York, then New Orleans. The Netherlands is on that list too, number 9, with $96 billion at risk in 2050. That's a lot of dollars in the top 10, trillions at risk, assets. But what strikes me of this picture is Africa. Africa does not light up. So if we only look through the lens of money, of finance, of assets at risk, then the poor will lose out. Because in 2050, the worth that is at risk will be not enough to intervene. So we have to rethink how we look at it. World Economic Forum put water crisis number one on the list for the next decade as the most impactful crisis. But look at number two. Mankind's inability to mitigate and adapt. And number three, extreme weather events. And number four, food crisis. So this top four of the most important crises of the world are all related to water. This is the world when you look at water, and mark my words, red is not a good color. But it's also an urban world, a world where people live in vulnerable places, in deltas, next to rivers, on coastal parts. And those places also have, on an international level, the opportunity to turn into a conflict, because water doesn't really care about man-made boundaries. A river just crosses. We're dependent, not because of the boundaries we make, but because of the water that crosses. Ethiopia builds a dam in the Nile. What does Egypt do? It's impacting their livelihood, their food and agriculture business. Do they change or go to war? 65 rivers cross the border between Bangladesh and India. Each individual one of them, reason of conflict. Lagos and Cambodia and China are building dams by the dozens, impacting Vietnam, for instance. What does this cause? Next to economic default and environmental disasters, or can they become opportunities for collaboration? The G7, a year ago, concluded that climate change is a matter of national security. You all know this. We all knew this. But the fact that they concluded on it in an official way is important, because it means that we can act. Part of the document the G7 produced under the leadership of Germany was the heat map created by the Opportunity for Water Crisis. This is the one. If you add everything up, and this is only part of it, and you look to the future, it's not a bright future. That's why the World Economic Forum risk report is so instrumental. On the left side, you see the urgency. Crises build up: environmental, man-made, social, cultural, geopolitical. We will have more of them, and it's going to be worse. An increase in impact and an increase in likelihood. So that's like the nightmare. When I wake up at night sweating, I think about the left side of the slide. But when I wake up at night smiling, I think about the right side of the slide. Because the World Economic Forum risk report also shows that there is a clear interdependency between those risks. An interdependency between those risks in their origin. Well, that's nice. This is where we mitigate. This is where our mitigation strategies come in. If we make them more comprehensive, we can actually strike a balance. But also an interdependency on their impact, and mostly on a regional urban scale. And this is where planners and designers come in. This is where we have the issue of better governance. So on the regional scale, if we work together and work on a comprehensive approach, we can deal with this complexity. Mankind might be the only species that not only messes up, but also is capable of dealing with its own mess because of that interdependency. But for that, we have to lift ourselves up. We have to change the perspective, turn it around. Four things are important if you want to change that perspective. One, you need a long-term comprehensive approach. You need to deal with the long term in a comprehensive way. Understand it, do research, and get a real understanding of interdependencies, vulnerabilities, and opportunities. But that long term approach needs to be connected to projects, interventions on the short term. Because long term approaches become books on a shelf, empty, most of the time useless, if they're not connected to investments, to real projects, to different facts on the ground. So long-term approaches need to be connected to short-term interventions. There's a necessary connection back. A short-term project is nothing but an incident if it's not connected to a strategy, if it's not connected to a long-term approach. And incidents don't add up to resiliency. Incidents don't make a difference. So long-term needs to be connected with short-term. Over and over again, with feedback loops and evaluations and monitoring. Second, you need the funding for it. And funding only comes when you're transparent and accountable. So we need better benefit cost analysis. Benefit cost analysis that actually can capture long-term resiliency questions, that can deal with comprehensiveness. And right now we don't have those benefit cost analysis. They can only deal with short-term infrastructure, simple approaches. The more complex they become, the more cultural or social they are, or more environmental assets they are dealing with, the more PMs there are in those benefit cost analysis models. And monitoring and evaluation? Well, even the Dutch are not so good in monitoring and evaluation. And across the world, we fail in learning and turning that feedback loop in. Now, if we reach out to the private sector and we don't have a transparent business case to provide, why would they invest? I mean, we put taxpayers' dollars all over the world in projects that are not transparent, but private sector is a little tougher. But democracy should be able to act the same way as a stake or stakeholder or shareholder. So private and public sector should have that same transparency and the same accountability. So then we have long-term and short-term and accountability and transparency for financing. But then the process. To get to these innovative projects and interventions, it has to be inclusive. It has to be collaborative, including all, not only institutions, but also activists and NGOs. Not only public, but also private. Not only collectives, but also individuals. If we get an approach that's really collaborative and really inclusive, we will make a difference. And if you do that, you build capacity. Number four. Building capacity amongst institutions, amongst individuals, amongst NGOs, researchers and businesses and investors builds the opportunity to enhance and increase the way we deal with these uncertainties. When Hurricane Sandy hit New York, it looked like this, and it ended like that. Hurricane Sandy hit the United States, where a president runs office that really knows what climate change is. He says you can ignore the facts, but you can't deny them. But he has to deal with a Congress that actually says differently. This is the man in Congress that is responsible for the Environmental Committee. And he says, well, man can't change climate, only God can. Now, I was hoping, this is not a talk about religion, but when the Pope came in and actually said man did change climate, and men should change back again, I was hoping that Mr. Inhofe might be a Catholic, so he might listen to the Pope. But he was a Protestant, so that failed. Sorry. Yeah, he actually should not have been a Protestant, but hey. And I'm not Catholic, so I wouldn't know any of this. The other part of climate change is that it's slow. In the US, we joked it's slower than Congress. But I challenge you, what was sea level rise in the last 100 years? How many? Silence? What was sea level rise in the last 100 years? Come on. Don't disappoint me. What was sea level rise in the last 100 years? Wild guess. It's okay. You can say 27 meters. It's wrong, but you can say it just to start the discussion. 2 inches. Who wants more or less? 2 meter. Whoa, no. That would have been fast. Sea level rise was not even an inch. 24 to 26 centimeters, a little bit depending on where you were. So that's slow for politics. 26 centimeters over 100 years, that's slow. Politics can't catch up with that. They don't even have to deal with it. So when Sandy hit, it also proved the World Economic Forum report was right. It showed these interdependencies on the ground. It showed that in red, poor people live in blue, poor places. Blue is where Sandy walked in. This is New York. This is Manhattan. Sandy flooded the whole region. Now, I was here in New Jersey City, industrial site. The surge was higher than this room, 5 meters, going into an industrial site where they store Agent Orange in a chemical facility, but also have social housing and low-income housing and poor people. And they had to close the playgrounds at night because the soil lit up. The soil was so contaminated, kids could not play there anymore. So all of a sudden, an environmental disaster like a storm became a catastrophe for mankind because of the pollution. The swamp area there was devastated, not only by too much water, but by the pollution it brought. Power supply, 75% in the floodplain, 80% of fuel storage in the same floodplain. So Sandy showed the uncertainties in the region and questioned physical as well as social resiliency. It also showed the vulnerability for electricity infrastructure. Taking out one power plant on Manhattan, turning Manhattan into a NOPO and a SOPO, a north of power and a south of power, blackening out half of it. And that in a region with bad governance, different governance across the states, wrong positions or worse positions of mayors, no mayors at all on Long Island. So accountability, not in the position to deal with the aftermath of Sandy. An implementation agency that are hijacked by politics. So a complex place when it comes to governance. In that condition, the federal government said we're going to allocate $60 billion for the rebuilding. And they put together a task force under the leadership of Sean Donovan, a presidential task force, to lead that effort. So with all these big numbers, hundreds of thousands of houses lost, $65 billion of damage in the region, and a task force leading it. And then when you walk around the region, this is what you find on the wall. And then you realize that with that big numbers and all that big effort, you tend to forget the small human need. Because when a disaster hits, it is a personal disaster. This man lost his wife, his house, and his business. For him, there's no way forward. There's only a way back, going back to what he has lost. For him, a task force and $60 billion do not make a difference. So if we want to have an impact on the world, to change, then professionals should not only work together, government, researchers, businesses, but professionals should work together with the people that can bring in their questions of need to the table and start to collaborate to really build resiliency opportunities that make a difference on a personal level. If we can't close the gap between professionals and people, we will fail. We will fail in our strategies to build resiliency. So some say, never waste a good crisis. One, a crisis is never good, and yes, we should not waste it, but use it to bridge the gap. Luckily, Sean Donovan was chair of the task force, intelligent man, commissioner of New York, architect by training, married a Jersey girl. He knows the region. He's born and raised in New York. And Donovan went to the Netherlands. Now, why did he go to the Netherlands? He went to me, where I was director general for water and spatial planning, and he went to the Netherlands to learn about water. Now, this is the Netherlands in the 1600s. Any one of you knows the Netherlands now? Been there? Saw it on an image? Map? Yeah. If we would have done a business case, a cost-benefit analysis in the 1600s, we would have moved to Germany or France, depending on our background. But we didn't. We built a great country, like you build a great country. We built polders, over 3,500 of them. Not because an engineering job, but because they're a collective effort, a collaboration on a regional scale. We discovered that collaborating is the only way to build safety. Not to build a wall around my house, but on a community level, collaborate to build safety for that community. Already in the 1100s, we had our first governance structure, before we were a country, before we were a kingdom. And that governance structure is now assessed by the OECD with an A+, and becomes a standard and an example for the world. We had more disasters in the 1400s, but we turned the land, the water into land, creating safety with a system with over 22,000 kilometers of dikes. A system that also is infrastructure. Infrastructure reaching way back down, deep down into Europe, creating the opportunity for the water sector to, as of this day, play a very important role on our economy. 75% of trade over water in Europe is in Dutch hands. We build our cities around us, around it, and created an institutional frame. An institutional frame that was dedicated at water. In the 1100s, a water authority, the establishment of Rijkswaterstaat, which is the federal organization that deals with water safety, again, before we were a kingdom, a ministry of water, as of 1800, still existing as a Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment, all the way down to 2015 last year, where they actually now have a special water envoy. Oh, it was great to have this background. We created the Zuiderzee Works, the Afsluitdijk, based on the storm in the 1960s. But the plans were already in the making. In 1953, we had a devastating storm, killing over 1,800 people. That was the start of the Delta Works. The Delta Works that safeguard the Netherlands until now. The problem with those interventions in response to disaster that they tend to be less intelligent. But the process of the Delta Works was reflective. So the last dam actually was informed by an environmental perspective more than a safety perspective. It became an open structure, so the water could be let in to create a healthier environment. Because man-made structures can bring safety, but can also be very destructive. In 95, due to rain and almost flooding, it made us realize that the Netherlands is not only vulnerable from the sea, it's also vulnerable from the rivers. So we developed a program called Room for the River, creating more room for those rivers. In 34 projects with 2.3 billion working all over in the Netherlands. A Room for the River based on principles, deepening the summer bed, storage in the lakes, relocation of the dikes, strengthening them, having high water channels, lowering of floodplains, depoldering, and removing obstacles, which meant houses and farms. Now, this is tough, also in the Netherlands, to move houses and farms. One example is the Overdiepse Polder. It's a polder next to the river, and it needed to be used as calamity storage for water. But there were also farms. Now, you know, talking to a farmer, saying that he or she or they have to leave as a family is one of the toughest things to do. Talking to a group of farmers is even worse. So the first years were not so good, not really collaborative. The farmers made a better plan. They said to the government, we want to stay. But the government said, no, we need your polder for water storage. But they said, remember, 2,000 years ago, we all lived in water areas, but we raised our houses on terps, higher parcels of land. And that's exactly what those farmers did. They presented a plan, we built new farms on raised land, and they're still there. And they're now part of the water containment area. Almost the same happened next to Nijmegen, a city. Nijmegen in the south, another city in the north, Lent. This was dedicated for urbanization, but we needed to create a second river for more capacity in. This was the opportunity for urbanization, urban development, and adding value by increasing the capacity of that river. Those projects were built through a different lens. Creating more room for the river was based on two principles: safety and quality. And those are actually the principles of life, the principles that are the basis for our land, the Netherlands. Safety one, quality one. You need them both. Quality for the environment, for life, for mankind. And we built with nature on the coast. We built urban in our cities, creating water safety measures that are comprehensive, but are also integrating more functions, like a parking garage or public space. But by integrating those functions, really add value on a different level. Higher and bigger dikes, a new harbor extension, the intertwining of the city and the river in Rotterdam, urbanization in our lakes, bringing the water back into our cities, connecting it to our recreational network. But does it mean that we are safe? No. Can you fix a water problem? Never. Water is life, but is also there for life. So you'll never stop working on water. This is not something about a quick or a slow fix. This is cultural. You have to keep working on water. This was this summer, flooding in Amsterdam. Not because a dam or a dike broke, because a water leakage next to the hospital, but it created kind of a mess. This is actually a windsurfer, and I said it's a sport from the 80s, but that's actually not so true. In Vilnius, a whole dike came down and flooded the whole area. So in the Netherlands, you always have to be ready, have to be prepared, because water is always there. 26% of the Netherlands is below sea level, but 60% is flood prone. This is that 60%. In that flood prone area, most of our people live and most of our economy is earned. When Hurricane Katrina happened in 2005, we realized perhaps we are not safe on the long run. And we asked the committee to advise us, and they came up with an advice to come up with a long-term approach, a 100-year plan, a Delta program. Safety against flooding, fresh water supply until the end of the century. A multi-layered approach where it was not only about safety by dams, dikes, and levees, but also about comprehensive and integrated planning, building resiliency in our systems and cities, and at the same time be ready, be aware, be alert, and invest in response measures when something goes wrong. This man, our colleague Wim Kuyke, is responsible for the development of that plan and the implementation. But it is more. It is about water quality and the governance of water quality, and it's our maritime sector being a global player. Living in this Dutch delta is a cultural thing. When Sean Donovan visited me in the Netherlands, he said it's cultural. Can it be cultural in New York? Cultural in New York, where the response to disaster is only repair, where the response to disaster started at $10 billion and now adds up to almost $100 billion a year, where the response to the disaster adds up to this. Don't laugh, this is federal policy based on the National Flood Insurance Program. You have to raise your house in the response to disaster before you get your funding. So President Obama wanted something else. He asked for a climate action plan and a hurricane rebuilding strategy. I worked on his task force for 2 years to come up with the strategy, but also do something innovative. Because he said, I not only want to rebuild this region, I want it to become an example for the US and the rest of the world. Bring me those interventions, projects that can help change the thinking and working on resiliency when it comes to those futures uncertainties. And I remember this long-term approach and innovative projects, the connection between public and private, partnerships and financing, collaboration across the board, being inclusive, and building up the capacity to deal with these uncertainties. Next to that, it is important when you want to collaborate to create a place that is safe, a place where it's not about negotiations, but really about collaboration. You also need to create room in a political and policy process for a little thinking out of the box or outside of legal frameworks, of outside of policy barriers. You need to think of the past as much as of the future to inform current day decision making. And you should use design and innovators and researchers to come up with measures you haven't thought of that are connecting different issues from the environment, the cultural, social, and economic part. No superheroes, and the talent of the region, the ones that are affected, the people, should be connected with the talent of the world, the professionals that know everything, but actually not. This match of real talent with real talent, small and big, actually adds that value. And collaborate, like we did in the 1100. Collaborate in an inclusive way. And inclusiveness means the door should be always open. One is never too late, because otherwise you'll fail. You lose out and you forget. Rebuild by Design became also a Dutch-US collaboration, a competition where we started with a research to get a better understanding of the region's vulnerabilities and ended up with coalitions, 10 coalitions with over, through a collaboration with over 500 organizations, thousands of people, in 9 months developing solutions that were able to change the region. A region at risk with real community needs. A region at risk that through a collaboration of federal agencies, local and state governments, public and private partners, design teams, innovators, NGOs, activists, loaners in that region had transformative capacity. 10 teams came up with designs across the board, from architecture all the way to a regional scale, connecting the politics of these big guys with the real local need on the ground. Driven by design, driven by the idea that we can change the world with innovation. MIT developed a plan for the Midlands, OMA for Hoboken, Deltares and team a plan for Room for the River, Penn Design a project for Hunts Point, the big team together with Arcadis for protecting Manhattan, Scape for protecting Staten Island. Every project had a different take. More environmental, more urban, more infrastructure, more small-scale communities, more big-scale economies. We selected 6 winners and allocated $920 million for implementation. And as we speak, they are ready to be implemented. Leadership, collaboration, and innovation drove ownership on the ground in those communities by design. But it also informed the government. So this detour I talked about went back. Federal government asked for a national competition. And I created the National Disaster Resiliency Competition that just had its 14 winners in January. But also helped create an international challenge in the Horn of Africa, the Sahel, and parts of Southeast Asia. Rebuild got some awards, but more importantly, was replicated and an inspiration for other places. For one, in San Francisco. So Rebuild did not make a plan, but changed the culture. Now, what does it have to do with Singapore? Singapore and water have a same and different relationship when you look at the Netherlands. 48 major waterways. We only have 4 rivers. 48 major waterways with their storage capacity. And a policy that's aimed at collecting every drop. You have 4 national taps, local new water imported and desalinated. And a water loop that brings back every drop you can catch. You bring back water in your urban core with adding quality, for instance, in Bishan Park. But water is more complex than only Singapore as an island can deal with. You're in an international environment, and as an island, you have to deal with it. The Indian Ocean, trade agreements, and the straits they come with, but also the natural resources, natural gas flows, and those of trade, impacting the way Singapore and the region deals with water. Now, what's interesting is that if you think about the marine part of Singapore, it's only very small. It's a little stretch. So I'll make the comparison with the Netherlands now. Singapore, hub of the world. There's always nice pictures. We do the same. Rotterdam, hub of the world. But we are part of the same network, which is interesting. If we analyze trade from Rotterdam, look at the bulbs. Houston, Rotterdam, Singapore. They all add up. Important in a network of connecting our economies, our culture, our environment. Singapore is also small in scale, amazingly. So this is the Netherlands, this is Singapore. Looks weird, but if you zoom in, they're almost the same. It's like an island in front of the coast. The temperature is a little different. You have a denser population than we have, but actually the Randstad is as dense as Singapore. Your GDP is a little higher, a little lower, but per capita, it's a little higher. We have landscape that is fragmented by policy, but integrated by practice. You have the same. Policy does not integrate, but it helps to increase capacity. Do you have room for agriculture? Or are you going to build farms on stilts in the water? We actually made plans on farms on the water, so we can help each other out. We're building this in Rotterdam, but why don't we export it to Singapore? Well, you export your intelligence on solar power building on the water. Now, another comparison, land reclamation. You added land to your island. We added land to our island, lots of it. So on this scale, perhaps not so important. But I was thinking about this as a business case. This is your plan, your spatial plan. This is your country with the water. If you fill it up, you just increase the island. This is exactly what you're doing. And I'm not advocating for filling everything up, but rethinking the position of Singapore and its borders and the way you use it as a land. And then, you know, look at this. It's almost a reunion. Two islands. We made a plan once for islands. It's actually for our safety. So if we would export Singapore to the Netherlands, it would actually build more safety. Now, it's ridicule, but also not. There's some real seriousness in making this comparison. We worked on our North Sea because it's full. Full of initiatives, but also full of real projects. And we came up with a spatial plan, a marine spatial strategy. On Monday, I had a great workshop talking about your marine spatial strategy. And it's a way to connect two worlds and make it better. Planning works on land, and I make the comparison between Singapore and Jakarta. Because of your planning, the vegetation cover went up. Because of no planning, it went down. I always make the comparison between the Netherlands and Belgium, where you almost have the same. Now, thinking of these big issues of agriculture, food, energy, urbanization, quality of life, why don't we bring Rebuild by Design to Singapore? An innovative process of collaboration, dealing with the biggest issues mankind deals with right now. We made a promise to the world in Paris that we will change the world. Well, that change can start here in Singapore, because we have no time to waste. Because the future is not so much about us, but really about them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ovink. Ladies and gentlemen, during the Q&A session, we ask that you please state your name and organization before asking questions or making comments. You may raise your hand and our staff will walk to you with the microphone. I would now like to invite Mr. Chua Soon Guan to join Mr. Ovink on stage for the moderator's discussion and Q&A. I will now hand the time over to Mr. Chua.
Okay, I believe all of you have enjoyed the 40 minutes tour of the world from outer space to New York to Netherlands and finally landed back to Singapore. But certainly it gave us a very broad perspective of the issues on water and the challenges, the complexity, the interdependencies. So on that note, maybe we open up to the floor for you all to raise your questions and your comments. The usual thing is that please state your name, where you're from, and keep your question and your comments concise so that we have more time for dialogue, as well as allow for more time for other people to raise their questions and comments. So on that note, maybe anyone want to raise the first question? Yes, please. Can we pass the microphone to... Yeah.
Hello, my name is Lim Sun Heng. I'm from a company called Clothing Solutions. Right, I think the strategy for Singapore is not in terms of rising sea levels, is not in terms of defending by means of boulders or breakwaters. Our strategy should be in terms of finding space on floating structures. Because if you look at the geography of Singapore, you can't really find, you know, you can't build a Moses Dam or Thames Barrier. Even our Marina Barrage doesn't protect us, right? So I have always been advocating that we should live with our sea space. We should find means to create floating structures and increase that space for development. This could be in the form of shifting out some of our industrial facilities, or in terms of shifting out land-intensive parklands or golf courses, things like that. And by so doing, I think we have capacity to at least increase our land areas by maybe 25-30%. Land in terms, in inverted commas, meaning floating lands, right? Because as we create floating lands, we also release the space on the mainland.
So your question?
I have no question. I'm just making a commentary for others to comment on. Thank you.
Well, you already do this. At 25% is actually impossible because you don't have so much sea. You can increase capacity also by floating. But I don't believe in silver bullets. Floating is not the solution, but can be part of the solution. There's never one way forward. Yeah, we always used to say there's no one road to Rome, which is of course true. But there are different ways towards that future. But I think we should take into account, like, the idea of those floating farms and floating energy. You can have floating parks and floating golf courses or floating houses, but they don't all add up to a more resilient structure. They don't make the mainland of Singapore more capable of dealing with rain events, more capable of dealing with increased heat, or they don't reduce the use of water, and they don't reduce the use of energy. So they're part of a bigger frame, a bigger game, perhaps, but they can be very inspirational. Yes.
Any more comment? Yes,
please. Hi, my name is Anna Ponting. I'm with the CLC. And I was working for the New York City government in the aftermath of Sandy, and so the sense of urgency that that created, and also the sense of urgency that I imagine the Netherlands faced in all of its natural disasters, I think sets a separate context to what Singapore is facing with less of a natural disaster-based context, I guess, where if you don't have that sense of urgency, how do you think that you should build the consensus, both politically and in the community, to get these kinds of projects to be a priority?
So, I understand your question perfectly. When I was in San Francisco, in my time when I worked and lived in the USA, there's a like a CLC in San Francisco. It's called Spur. We had a dinner with the board of directors. And the CEO said to me, hey, Henk, that was easy in New York. You had this Sandy. But hey, we don't have a disaster. And I asked back, do you need a disaster to be smart? Which is actually your question. The thing with the Netherlands was that in 1995, there was not a real disaster. But it made us rethink our vulnerability. And in 2005, the disaster was in the United States. It made us rethink our long-term strategy. So you can be smart without a disaster. So it's not so much about the disaster, but it's about awareness and will. And awareness and will come together when you have a better understanding. And I think that better understanding is a lot of the time lacking or is siloed up, balkanized or fragmented. So I think organizations like CLC and others, but also a collaboration between the Netherlands and Singapore, can increase that capacity of understanding, raising awareness, showcasing opportunities, and opportunities are always connected to will. So if we can come forward with the right opportunities, action and investment, increase again awareness and the opportunity for decision makers to showcase their will to change. I believe we don't need more disasters. Disasters are terrible. But we need more will and the power to make the decision based on the right information, but also the right cases. Perhaps it's harder, but also not. If you look at New York now, is it better off than it was before Sandy? No. Although they're doing great in rebuilding, people still died, people still lost their houses, people still lost their businesses. And Sandy was not a big disaster. Big in money, but not in people. When Haiyan hit the Philippines, that was a big disaster. When the typhoons hit India, Bangladesh, Myanmar, those are big disasters. So you're more vulnerable when the small island states of the world just disappear because of sea level rise. New York can deal with it. I only want to use it as an inspiration, but it's not an example. Disasters are tough, and we rather prevent their impact with better solutions than that we have to deal with the trouble they leave us after they're gone.
Sorry, Raymond Kwok from Kwok Global LP. Can we come to the questions about drinking water? Do we, Netherlands as well as Singapore, do we have some projections as to how we're going to manage the growth of the population and the drinking water? Singapore, we now got a fifth tap. We're looking at groundwater. So beside those other four, can you share with us how Netherlands sort of solved the water issues in terms of drinking water? And what is the projections of the population and how you manage that?
Europe is in a different position than Asia when it comes to demographics. We're shrinking. We gave up on the old world, actually. Yeah. So join us in Europe, drinking water enough. But in the times when we were still growing fast, we also invested a lot, in our drinking water. Now in the Netherlands, it's curious. I always find it interesting. The water quality of the Netherlands is one of the best of the world. And then somebody asked me the question just the other week. 2 weeks ago, a report came out that this water quality of the Netherlands is amazing. And somebody said, why? And I said, why? It's great. He said, yeah, but why is this high standard of quality for agriculture? For energy, for flushing my toilet and taking a shower? Why do we invest so much in those things that might need less investment? So our system is so high-end that it's actually not efficient, which is interesting. But we're very effective, and we consider the best quality of water as a public good. We pay taxes for it, We manage it. We have the best water technology companies and researchers. I'm very proud of them, and they work very hard. But we also have a good collaboration between industry, being agriculture or chemical or the harbors, and the government to reduce the use, reuse the water, and clean it in the right way. We do have problems with leftover materials, chemical leftover materials, also for medications. We use more medication all over the world, and it's hard to get it out of the water. But at the same time, we innovate over and over again. So the lesson here is there are different opportunities for capturing water. You have four taps. I presented the four of them. Talking to some Dutch companies, they just invented a fifth and a sixth one. So you have to ask one of them, because they're here in the room. They will be able to add to that capacity water brings you. I don't think Singapore is in a position of having real scarcity as they have in Syria, but there is a pressure on capturing enough water. But there is also an opportunity for reuse and reduce that increases in that sense. Not so much the quality, which is great, but the quantity of the water that's there.
My name is Helena Hulsman from Deltares, Singapore. You gave a lot of examples of how Singapore, both Singapore and the Netherlands, have developed solutions and tools to deal with, well, the Netherlands more safety against flooding, and Singapore perhaps more on water provision, so water security. And I think that has given both of the countries a great position to share that knowledge and those tools with the rest of the world that might be in dire need of these solutions. So how do you have thoughts of how the Netherlands and Singapore can work together in distributing these tools or solutions and sharing this knowledge to other countries, either in the region or worldwide?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. Could you elaborate, please?
Yeah, I will, a little. The capacity here in, so that's the interesting part. A lot of the time we talk about really vulnerable places in the world that not always or often not have the capacity to rethink and invest, research and implement. That's the partnership countries like Singapore and the Netherlands should form. We formed a coalition between countries that have the same deltas. But we also have partnerships between the Netherlands and Singapore to not only work together to help solve each other's problems, but also collaborate across the world on different issues. Now, there was an opportunity, there is an opportunity that I raised in September on my last visit here, which also was my first, sorry. That is this Singapore International Water Week, the World City Summit, and the Sustainability Week. 3 weeks in one with the attention of the world. So I said, why don't we work together towards that week and present some of those collaborative solutions, not so much to showcase how good we are, but to reach out a hand to the world and say, we want to be your partner in solving water crises all over the world, because we can bring to bear the knowledge, experience we collectively have, and bring that capacity for change, not only in the communities in Singapore and the Netherlands, but through to the communities around the world. So I think having that discussion in July here in Singapore of not so much showcasing what we did in the past, but presenting opportunities for how to collaborate in the future together is ideal. So you're from Deltares, and with this I again invite you and your organization to partner with us and Singapore organizations, government and businesses, to present some best practices, opportunities for future collaboration, not alone in Singapore and the Netherlands, but in those places that are in dire need for our solutions.
Any more comments and questions? Maybe while you're thinking, let me ask Hank a question. I was quite impressed by some of the graphics that you show, especially when you compare Singapore and the Netherlands. In a way, it shows that actually both Singapore and the Netherlands somehow we managed to find our place in the world in the various things that we do. But based on your understanding of the two countries and also having involved in so many international projects, what do you think will be, or what, how should we ensure, what do we need to do to ensure that the seemingly success of Singapore and the Netherlands will continue? Because we tend to celebrate the success of the past, but certainly that doesn't guarantee that we will be so in the future. So is there any lessons or insights that you can share with us? How do we ensure that we can continue to be, in a way, the keynotes as you presented on your slides?
That's the toughest part, because I can't look into the future. There's no guarantee that collaboration will be our main way of looking at the future. But I'm an optimist. I'm a son of my mother. She passed away 5 years ago, but I'm proud that I have her genes. Because she had to believe that man in the world, mankind in the world, is there to do good. Although it's not always proven right, I think collaboration is based on that mutual understanding. There's another driver, more formal. We have SDGs and a COP agreement. We should deliver water security for all. But is that really changing a culture? Most of the times not. So last, it's on us. It's on us, professionals, politicians. It's on us, students, researchers, businesses. It's on us to make that promise to each other that we will never let go. And in that sense, water is so inspirational. It never lets go of us. We can't deal without it. So every day we have to find new solutions to deal with the issues and opportunities water brings. And as long as we remember that dealing with them for more prosperity, more safety, happiness, and quality for our children and grandchildren, as long as we remember that it can only happen if we collaborate, then we will always find each other. But it's a promise we have to make to ourselves, not so much to our neighbors. So that means that there's no guarantee, but I do believe it will happen.
Yes, Ambassador.
Thank you very much. Yes, I'd like to go back to Sandy in the United States. And I was just wondering, basically, after all the implementation work has been done, the simple question is, how much more resilient will New York, New Jersey be? I mean, will they be fit for a new Sandy or a Sandy Plus? And how do you calculate that? I mean, what was your target there? And my related question is, I'm very much intrigued by what you call the collaborative approach, inclusiveness. But there you have all these people with all these bright ideas at community level that you have to take on board. At the same time, you have these sort of fixed requirements, standards in your head that you know must be fulfilled in order to achieve this resilience, so that this will not happen again, or at least it will happen again, but will not make that much damage. So how did you, what can you tell the people as far as the outcome is concerned in terms of resiliency?
So, New York is, in a way, on high ground, but not everything in New York. So with a normal storm, they're okay. With a Sandy Plus, they're in trouble. But they have plans that started before Sandy, were topped up because of Sandy, that are in the making now, and they're part of the 25 to 30 billion program the city of New York pushed forward, but also part of the program New Jersey, because it's a region and the region is vulnerable, and the state of New York are pushing forward. So one is, as we know in the Netherlands, when we said, are we fit for the future? No, we have to work on it every year and invest on it every year. So we spend more than €1 billion every year on investments for water safety. New York is spending over the is spending more like that in the same level for rethink. Are they ready now? No, it will take time. Second, how do you combine collaboration with those high standards in the same way as you deal with the investment, step by step? You don't solve these over time. But the collaborative process was also really about getting a better understanding amongst all, a better understanding among professionals of what real local needs were to inform designs and innovations, but also a better understanding of the people at risk in the region, of what climate change and the impact of climate change really meant, to inform what they had to do to improve their safety, but also improve their policies. So in that sense, these learning processes are not only building dams, dikes, and levees, or building oyster reefs or natural structures to protect surges coming in. They also build awareness and the capacity among communities to deal with those uncertainties. They also inform policy. One example, when Sandy hit Manhattan on the Lower East Side, there's hospital row. Three hospitals in a row, hospital row. The Bellevue Hospital, which is the most south one of them, had flood defense structures that were washed away by the surge. So the surge was tough. The emergency generator was on the roof. Smart thinking. Huh? We don't do that in the Netherlands. We're -4 or -5. We put emergency generators in the basement. We're not always smart, you could say. Actually stupid. But they put it on the roof. But there is policy in New York that is not connected to these generators on the roof that says only if you're a gas station you can store fuel above the ground. So the fuel for the emergency generator was in the basement. So the hospital flooded and the doctors carried buckets of gasoline up the stairs to ensure that the generator kept working to provide electricity to serve the patients that were still in dire need of that help right after Sandy. I visited that hospital together with Secretary Napolitano and Secretary Donovan right after Sandy, and the director of the hospital ensured us that no one died. So that was good. The doctors worked hard, carried those buckets. Everybody got evacuated at the right time, even those two patients that had to wait long because they were operated. But that informed the policy framework for New York, saying, well, this is a weird rule. So evaluation after Sandy, what I said, the risk report, how these interdependencies work. A surge, a storm, a disaster is like a magnifying glass over whatever you've done to a region, a place. And this magnifying glass you have to take really serious. So this was an opportunity to change the policy. Also an opportunity to change standards. When an elevator, when there's a fire in a building, the elevator goes down. You can't use it. Now when there's a flood, it does the same because it causes a shortcut in the circuit. So the elevator goes right into the water. Easy, these are easy things. You can just used technology to prevent the elevator when there's a flood to actually go into the water. Especially helpful when the elevator is full of people. So there are easy solutions to hard questions, and that learning capacity is critical.
Sorry. My name's Uy from Falcon Crest. I have two questions. I look at these floating structures, and I have two questions. How long of a lifespan can you design this structure for? Can it be 50 years, 100 years or more, or is it meant to be temporary? And when you build a floating structure, in terms of getting permission, do you go to the land authority to get permit, or you go to the maritime authority to get a permit? And also there's the valuation of the space. In land, we have land valuers, or in this kind of space, who's doing the valuation? How do you resolve? No, if you build something on land, you have a valuer on the land. But on the sea, who's doing the valuation? How much it going to cost you to build something on the sea? So these are just my questions. Thank you.
Interesting. Lifespan, it depends. That's the same with a house. We can't build houses to last forever. At a certain time, we fix them and fix them again, and then we'll tear them down and build something new. The lifespan of floating structures are perhaps sometimes longer than the structures we put on the land and sometimes shorter. Also really depending on the functions they have. This is a showcase pavilion in the city center of Rotterdam, not aimed at for living conditions. Next to that, we're actually building a floating neighborhood. So the whole neighborhood will float. To your question, who do you ask permission? It depends on who owns the water. So in the Netherlands, that could be local, regional, or national authority. It all depends. But you can't build floating structures everywhere. The Netherlands is a very regulated land. Well, that sounds familiar, I guess. And that means that it's always clear who has the authority. And if it's not clear, there's always clear amongst the authorities who's the boss. With our planning laws, we have a layered approach. We'll change it a little, but there's hierarchy. There's a national plan. There's regional ones, and there's local ones. Normally, you would not be able to build in the water, so you redo your zoning plan. But that's a normal procedure. We redo zoning plans everywhere. Now, there are even places in the Netherlands that 100 years ago, we turned water into land. Now we're actually gonna turn land into water and then put floating houses in. So the Dutch are sometimes a little weird. So the planning of that is actually very normal. So incorporating this in your planning is critical. And then how you value, that also depends when it comes. So the permission to build is a way to value. We never sell the water while we do sell the land. But in Amsterdam, which is totally different than Rotterdam, in Amsterdam, until a year ago, they never sold land. All the land was owned by the government and given in a lease. In Rotterdam, they sold the land. So the government has no or hardly any position when it comes to development. That's very complex. In Amsterdam, they now changed it because they were short on money. It's not the best motive to change that policy. On water, we'll use the Amsterdam model. It's a lease model. So there's different valuation of that model. And you have the same way of valuating the opportunity to build on land as there is on water.
Can I help this gentleman with this question? I used to work in a shipyard. right? Keppel Shipyard. And you know, Singapore has built many, many structures that are floating in the North Seas, in Mexico, Gulf, in the wherever. Structures like this can either be built of steel or they can be built of concrete. And designing, whether it's steel or concrete, designing for a 50-year life is not a problem. In fact, you can also design for a 100-year life. But usually your technical life is a lot longer than your economic life because the structure becomes quite valueless after 50 years, whereas your structure is still technically sound, and you know. So it's not a question of structural problems, but more a question of its economic value over time, right? The other thing is that on valuation, when you talk about valuation of a property or asset on land, you're talking about, you know, its location, because the value depends on its location. With structures that are floating, you can take a structure anywhere. You can float, you can build a building in Singapore, like we once built a floating hotel, and that floating hotel went to Brisbane, it went to Saigon, or Ho Chi Minh City, and now it's in North Korea. So valuation becomes very subjective because it's location dependent. All right? Thank you. I hope that helps.
Thank you. Any more? There's a question behind.
Hello, my name is Tess Tribos. I work for Witte Veen & Bos, an engineering consultancy. When you talked about reaching out to the private sector, connecting professionals with the people, I understood that you have professionals, actually two groups. You have the government professionals and the private sector professionals, as this is how I understood your explanation. And in that regard, I have a question, and also maybe a proposal. You mentioned closing the gap, and then a crisis can be used to close this gap between professionals and the public. But I feel that in enough countries already, you can also speak about a gap between the private and public sector of professionals. Wouldn't it be a first step, particularly for Singapore, without an actual acute crisis right now, to make sure that this is dealt with, and after that you can uniformly inform the layman, the people, get them involved, and also, how would that look like? Thank you.
No, I disagree. okay. There is no gap between public and private sector professionals. It's a chosen gap, but you all understand each other perfectly. You just choose not to understand each other. There is a real gap between professional and the public. I will explain why. I worked for both sides, and in collaboration it's hard, but hard is different than a gap. Hard is tough, and it doesn't always work. Hard means that sometimes you fight, and you disagree, or you don't connect. But you understand each other in interpreting the world perhaps differently. But there is not even a language between the public and the private, or the public and the public sector, that bridges that gap. Second, a process of collaboration has to involve all from the beginning. You can't start with professionals first, but we do all the time. Yes. And then professionals start to gain better understanding. And professionals actually gain so much understanding that they start to work on bringing that understanding towards solutions. And then the next conversation is with the people that don't understand anything of that conversation, and all of a sudden are confronted with half-baked or fully fleshed out solutions that you need buy-in from. That's not collaboration, that's an insult. If you really take collaboration serious, you have to be able to be vulnerable at the beginning and say on this table where government, researchers, private sector sit, that perhaps don't work together, but understand each other. You also invite the others that normally would not be on that table to start to inform the same process you would normally have when you want to bridge the so-called gap between the public and the private sector.
That's great. Thank you for your explanation. I agree with you that you need to incorporate the public from the beginning. But then again, is that also what we practice right now? Because, for instance, the summit coming up in July, are there people invited for this?
I'm not on the organizing committee.
The general. You are part of it, right?
Okay.
I'm invited. Yeah.
Great. I'm not saying it's your fault or anything, but I agree that, okay, yeah. So we have a thought about water issues, water safety. Singapore has its fair share in this regard, but also a lot of knowledge and lots of potential. And also a population which is highly engaged. Wouldn't they want to come? So maybe if this is... from your experience, what would work best? Maybe not you particularly, but in general, for such a summit, or would it be beneficial to also have local people from municipalities, from neighborhoods invited to join in and take part?
Have local forums. There are actually conferences where this is happening, where the doors are open, where you have local fora, where people can walk in when they're... I was just in New Orleans where I got questions from an audience. I definitely was sure it was not the professional crowd. Interesting organization in New York is the American Institute of Architects. There were always weird people in the room. It was like, where do you come from? I know you're not an architect. Great. Building up that capacity. So yes, there are all kinds of formats and opportunities. This is one. The other part is communities are well organized. So instead of saying that professionals, we, this room, should organize for communities, to join our processes, why don't we join their processes a little more? To really hear a different side of the story. Because we like to be in charge as professionals, because we think we're ahead of the game. But
they are actually ahead of the game. Yeah. Right.
So government or professional involvement is a different perspective than when you say public involvement. And public engagement actually still means that I have an idea, I want to present it to the public in whatever stage that idea is, and if they buy it or not, it's still my idea. But if you go the other way around, it starts a different conversation.
Okay, we have time for perhaps just one or two more questions. Perhaps I just take the questions first and we let Hang to respond to the questions. Yeah, Mr. John Ting.
Very interesting conversation. I hope I read you correctly, the takeaways. First of all, water is immutable. It's not something that you can actually address and manage completely. It's forever changing, right? So you need to be always watching it and redoing it again and again and again. Now, your history goes back a few hundred years. The water control, water management is a few hundred years, right? 11 something, if your chart says it correctly, almost 900 years. So it's wonderful for me to see a society that looks at this thing called water year in, year out for so many centuries and still thinking they are still behind what water cannot do. So that's an interesting message. I like your idea of rebuild by design, by the way. I think it's a smarter way to do things than to try to recover aftermath, which is always disastrous, right? The best you do is always the worst effort anyway, the result. I want to ask you, you've been here, first of all, July last year. You've done a workshop on Monday. And from how you speak, I know you're very knowledgeable. Huh? So I want to ask you a very naive question. From what you know of Singapore, what are three possible holes that we have that we don't even know? Because we are very young. We've only been looking at seriously for less than 50 years. Huh? So I think we're very naive and young. There are a lot of things we think is in order, we take it for granted, or we believe is in order, but we're not even aware of what is underneath us. So I want you to tell us three, or maybe at least two possible holes that we need to look at seriously. Thank you.
Okay, I saw a question in the back just now.
Yeah, thank you. My name is CTO. My company name is called CA Architects. Now, sorry. As you know, Singapore is an island, and our lowest level is about 0.5 to 1 meter above mean sea level. And I understand the PUB has a policy to raise our ground to minimum 104, 4 meters above mean sea level. My question is, based on your experience for the past few hundred years, is this the best solution for Singapore? That's mean the first thing come to our mind is to raise our ground.
So 4 meters plus.
104, right? Yeah.
In the United States, we, well, not me, but after Sandy, they said a foot. Sorry.
And,
so 4 meters sounds pretty progressive. But I don't want to compare you to the United States. Not at all, actually. I couldn't judge this because I never did the IPCC impacts on Singapore. So I wouldn't know what... Because you always have relative sea level rise. In Jakarta, it's the same sea level rise as here, but land decline is as much the other way as sea level rise for the last 100 years, but then every year. So, relatively speaking, it's very hard to give an opinion on your idea on this proposition, because I just don't have the knowledge on climate change impact in the specific case of Singapore. Then on the other question, I totally agree. It's about living with water. Which is different than fighting it. I don't believe in fighting water, because you'll lose. Water is stronger or more intelligent. It just bends. It's water does not fight. It just goes around you, and then it hits you from the back. So you better live with it, which is embracing it. There's also another part in that, and that is that don't think that you can fix climate change. It's such an engineering thought, fixing climate change. When I started to work in the United States, I got an interview, and the interviewer, the reporter said, "So, Mr. Ovink, are you going to build this storm surge barrier next to the Verrazano Bridge?" And I said, "Well, I don't know, but I don't think so. There's no silver bullet. If that would have been a solution, then it's always part of a series of interventions. And that series of interventions, due time and through time, will change and evolve, and new interventions or changes to the older ones are necessary. So living with water never stops, as is living with uncertainties. Uncertainties never stop. That's life. This is so great. This is what we can do as mankind, is that we change, we adapt. We do things differently than our fathers and mothers and our grandfathers and grandmothers did. And our kids, well, we know this for sure, are doing things differently than how we lived our lives. And sometimes it's frustrating or inspirational. So it sticks. Then your second question, the hardest one of the afternoon, the three holes Singapore was not thinking about. I don't know, of course. I'm totally new to this game here. Singapore is new. But what I do see is a country with a huge capacity amongst its citizens and professionals, with also, although perceived low resourceful, I think it's actually not so low resourceful. You have a lot of resources. You can rethink and use. Your land is used in an urban way. And there are cities around the world that have less of the value you have that you can bring to the table. So I think if I look at Singapore, it's always as a city-state. And as a city, as a metropole, as part of the world, you have a great amount of resources and quality you can bring. So sometimes it's also changing the perspective on what you have. On the seaside, on the land side, in the soil, so three-dimensional, as well as adding the fourth dimension, which is time. Tomorrow it will be different, but it also gives you the opportunity to not always solve everything today. Lastly, I wouldn't be a Dutch guy if I wouldn't promote cycling. But that was a no-brainer, so I'll stop with that.
Okay, I know you all still have some questions, but I think due to the time, I have to end it here. I'm not sure about you, but there are three insights that I take away from today's conversation as well as Hank's talk. One is about crisis. I think we should recognize that a lot of the crisis, whether locally or around the world, is water-related. And this crisis can be man-made or man-caused, for example, due to bad management of water, or it could be due to the nature and is exacerbated by what we say climate change. So crisis, we should not ignore crisis. And secondly, to respond to the crisis, collaboration is very important. It's no longer a government top-down effort. You need to actually collaborate with the communities, with the professionals, to get the best solutions, to get the more resilient solutions. And finally, I think there's this very important point which I really like, is that when we devise the solutions and the programs, it's not about big budget or big programs. At the end of the day, it's for care for the individuals. Whether the individuals, is it the homeowners or the businesses, whether they, how they benefit from the resilience programs, from the improvement programs. So I think you all will agree with me that it's a very enjoyable, enriching session this afternoon. And let's put our hands together to thank Henk.
Thank you, panelists, for sharing your insights and experiences with us. Please stay on stage. We would now like to invite Mr. Koo, Executive Director of CLC, on stage to present tokens of appreciation to the panelists and for photo taking as well. Mr. Koo, please. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our lecture, and we thank you for your participation. Do stay tuned to CLC Miller's and website for information on our upcoming events. We will also be seeking your feedback via email and would greatly appreciate if you could take some time to help us improve the lecture series. Have a good evening, and we hope to see you again. Thank you.